So he was a pathfinder. And this is 1964. It's civil rights, the Voting Rights Act is still a year off. Some folks down south still aren't voting. And this man can write a book about his path and his ancestors' path to equality. His mom was a really good friend and a mentor in the black community, the Cardinal Sheehan, Cardinal Lauren Sheehan, who in 1963 was compelled to write a pastoral letter saying to parishes and schools in the Archdiocese of Baltimore, you know, you need to integrate. I went to a Catholic school that had 800 kids in it. I didn't see a black person at my parish school until I was in the seventh grade. So, that's the landscape that Gene Fugett walked into. Gene Fugett graduated from Cardinal Gibbons High School in 1968. He was the first black man honored as Catholic Athlete of the Year by the Catholic War Veterans in Baltimore. And you can read about his past. He's played in Super Bowls. He's in a bunch of Hall of Fames. And now he's in the going to be inducted into the Baltimore Catholic League Hall of Fame. Come on up, Gene.
Thank you. Well, everybody that knows anything about basketball in Baltimore knows that we should probably just stop right now with Coach Wells. I mean, how can anybody come up here? I mean, who has touched more lives and more pieces than Coach Wells? Now, I grew up at Mosier and Papa Grove Street, and my earliest days were sitting on the side of my brother's bed. His name was Reginald F. Lewis. And I would wait for Reggie to come home to tell me what happened that day at Dunbar, because Reggie played football, basketball, and baseball for Coach Sugar Cane. I mean, I know what a good coach is. I mean, my dad played for Coach Hurt on the 49 undefeated team in Morgan, though. I'm from Baltimore, and I always say, Coach, I was one of the first from West Baltimore to go over and play in the Dome, because everybody knows that in Baltimore, basketball is born on the east side. I mean, my mother was born in a house on Mumford Avenue. She's still mad it's called Cassell Way. She said she was there before my cousin Sam, right? But Baltimore was basketball. And I remember when I was practicing law, I was telling somebody, I would like to be known for other than the Dallas Cowboys. And I was like, 4 years with the Cowboys and 4 years with the Redskins. And I thought being Carolyn Fugit's son, Reginald Lewis's brother, and now Audie Jones's dad, right? Tried to run Adam Jones away from my daughter. See how well I did with that. Now I got two grandkids. So I was born on third base, and mom at 90 still is telling me what to do. Because she tricked me when she sent me to Cardinal Gibbons at 12. I wasn't ready for that. And in fact, in my memoir, that'll be Welcome to the White World, because I didn't know what I was getting into. But I do know that I would not have made it out there without the education and the people who were there to support me. So first I want to thank all my Cardinal Gibbons people. Would you stand up, please, who are here tonight, especially John Reed, Pat Maggio, who I remember. And really, I want to thank you guys for putting up with me, occasionally passing me the ball, Doug Derringer. Because Doug said I had to remember Ace. I said, no, I got to talk about Ray Wallace. I mean, somebody actually came to me and said, Gene, did you know Ray Wallace? Did I know Ray Wallace? Oh my gosh. But I knew Ray Wallace because I thought I was a basketball player. And I was all set. I got a letter from Kansas. I'm going to University of Kansas. I'm going to be a basketball star. And then went to see the Bullets practice at the community center. And Earl Monroe walked past taller than I was. I said, oops, that's the end of the basketball career. So as fate would have it, Coach Bob Passwell, who was here earlier, was so fortunate to come up to me and ask me to try out for the football team, and which I did. And I went on to a college, but it was not without some pitfalls. I mean, in 1968, Bobby Ross, the football coach, was in Maryland working for Lou Holtz, trying to find the right player to integrate William & Mary football. Rumor has it he was recruiting two players, Kurt Schmoke, who went to Yale, and then when I found out he was recruiting to me, I went to an abolitionist school in the North because I wasn't ready at 16 to do that. And that's how times were changing. It's 1972 in the Dallas Cowboys. My agent says, you have to understand about Texas.
And I said, what is it that I have to understand? And he drove me to Greenville, Texas, where Dwayne Thomas was from. Now I know why Dwayne was like that. Because it had a banner that said, black as dirt, white as people. That's right, 1972, that was Texas. But to me, that wasn't a shock, because in 68, my mother couldn't try on a dress downtown. That's why I was never, I wouldn't like Baltimore. I didn't like the way I was treated at the time until I got older. And I had a chance to go to Boys Latin after the riots. And said in 1968, we had National Guard Jeeps in our neighborhood. And it was not an exciting time. And there were people talking about burning the American flag, which I kind of thought about. But somehow I avoided that trap and I stayed in school and got smarter and smarter. And finally, some of the things that I had wondered about all my life came to me. I wondered why my name was so weird, Gene Schloss Fugett Jr. Well, I found out that Schloss was my grandmother's maiden name. Her mother had escaped slavery during the Missouri Compromise. So my grandmother was born free in Kansas, graduated University of Kansas in 1912, had 87, 89 in high school, Cicero and Virgil. So that's probably why I was so smart. She got a letter from Booker T. Washington where she met my grandfather, Fugett. His father was a slave in Tennessee. We found the plantation, so Fugett is a slave name. That's right. I didn't know that, but I stayed in school. And I found that because my grandfather thought that his mother was Native American. See, this runaway slave married a woman off the Indian reservation up in New York. Her name is Josephine Electra Bateman. So my grandfather, Joseph Fugett, Cornell 1912, third class to the Alphas, made milk at Tuskegee, and for 51 years was principal of the Gay Street Elementary School in Westchester. So this is 50 years before Reginald F. Lewis High School. This is Joseph Fugett High School, named after my grandfather, which I didn't find out about until I was 18. Now, how many of you didn't know about your family history till you were 18, trying to figure out who you are, where you're from? So, turns out they got the casino with the Indians. I said, Dad, we're Indians and we're rich. You know, come on, self-interest, right? I said, you're a quarter, I'm an eighth, get up there and get our money. So he goes up and says, my grandmother was Josephine Electra Bateman, and the chief says she lived on the reservation, but she's not a member of the tribe. So here's where it really starts to get interesting. Oh, really? Well, who did Josephine descend from? Well, she descended from a mulatto named Henry Bateman, who was a free African who fought in the Revolutionary War. So now, I'm not Indian anymore. I'm a Native American with a flag in every room because my ancestor fought in the American Revolution. So I'm the president of the John Eager Howard chapter of the Maryland State Society of Sons of the American Revolution. So we're looking, we'll help you with your genealogy. I don't know if you'll be as lucky as I am, because if you stay in school, young people, you will learn, and it's no telling what you'll learn. Reg died in 1993. He got sick, he refused treatment because he said it would affect how he thought, and we had little time to prepare for what I had to do to go to 40 businesses in 30 countries. So it was something I still haven't really gotten over. I'm still mad at my brother for leaving me, because at the time we were trying to decide whether to make a bid for Chrysler or Universal. But he got sick, and it wasn't meant to be. So I was advised that I was going to be followed in Europe everywhere I went. Everything I said was going to be recorded, because in France I was what they call a strategic asset. I controlled 30% of their food. They wanted to know where I slept every night. Now my brother didn't tell me that part. But now, here I am over in France, and what do I have to fall back on? My education, my upbringing. I grew up at Mosier and Poplar Grove, so y'all know how I grew up. Tennessee Coast wasn't the first one to get held up, okay? I mean, I used to have $4 in my sock, right? So here it is, the education, the learning, the coaching, and then teamwork. Now, you never know how important that is to be a part of a team. I mean, with Tom Landry, I mean, I had some great coaches. I had three Hall of Fame coaches, Tom, George Allen. But Pat Wall and Ray Moss, they're the same, just like this coach here and all the coaches that are here tonight, because they don't do it really for the money. I mean, they get paid. But that's not why they're coaching, and you really just wonder what the heck you're doing. Well, I found out when I was in France, because I had to send my kids home because they did not have sports in their high school. They don't believe in team sports. They have like AAU. So I always like to ask the French, and every time I ask them a question, they would tiss me, oh, you Americans. And they said, well, you heard about World War II? And I said, well, what about it? Well, who would ever want to teach somebody to follow a leader? We want to have individuals. And that's, of course, why the guy wrote the book that World War II was a group of soccer players going one-on-one against a bunch of football players, where 90% of the American World War II soldiers played high school football. And we think that when you become part of a team, that team becomes something greater than yourself. Now, I don't know how much I contributed. I mean, I go to the Cowboys at 23 years, we're in the NFC Championship game. But again, it wasn't that much different than the first time that we beat Mount St. Joe, and I had to put that in there because we beat y'all. And I mean, and that was like the biggest game of my life. The only moment in my high school life bigger than that was during my four-game JV career in the ninth grade. And we were playing Dunbar at Carver. And at the end of the game, a man tall in stature, with a big hat and coat, a man I had heard about every day my brother Reggie came home, talking about this famous coach and how Dew Burns was throwing in towels. And I couldn't believe it. But when Coach Sugar Cane came to me and asked me, was I Reggie's brother? You would have to be from Baltimore to know how to this day I still remember that. And I tell people how lucky we were. We weren't like other cities. I mean, when Frank Robinson came here, we knew he was legit. What was the first headline? He was arrested in Cincinnati with a gun. That's the first thing the son had to say about the man. So we knew we had a real brother coming up in here. This is Baltimore. And I talked to Lenny Moore today and said, man, how did you do it? How could you have parties you couldn't even go to and you didn't say nothing about it? And the baby said, I bit my lip because I hoped that one day it would be better. Like all of us with our kids and grandkids, we hope that one day it was going to be better. And for all the people at Cardinal Gibbons, I can't tell you what an opportunity it was to be there at a time where we couldn't predict or know where we were going. But we were all in there together and we were all accepting each other. And I don't know why, maybe it was Catholic, maybe it was God, I don't know. But I know that it made me think, by the time I left there at 16, between that and being Carolyn's son and Reggie's brother, I could do anything I wanted. And so far, now that I'm in this Hall of Fame, it's all come true. So I want to thank you for being here tonight. I want to thank all the honorees. I want to thank my Amherst friends. I want to thank the board for having me. Thank you.